Thank you, everyone, for coming today. We're on a short schedule, so I'll get right to it. more than 3 years after one of the worst financial crises to hit in United States history, the government has been criticized, sometimes severely, for its failure to bring and to criminally prosecute senior executives at the large Wall Street institutions that many believe helped cause the financial crisis. Today, we address the key questions of whether this criticism has been fair or not, where do we go from here, and to evaluate what's been done so far. Before I start with the introductions of our really incredible panel today, I just want to give a couple of thanks to Michael Ore for helping to put this together, to Milbank for sponsoring, for the Prosecution Center, as we call it, for co-sponsoring, and two of the center's junior fellows, Xander Lee and Christina Dahman, for helping us put this together. And since this is 2012, I'd also like to thank the world of Twitter, who, after this was announced, helped supply a few sample questions, which I'll be asking today of our great panel. Now let me introduce our panelists. When Michael and Ricky came to me and came up with this idea of proposing a panel on this topic, we sat around and tried to think of who would be right, who would be the right people. And I have to say, it was almost like one of those, you know, who would win a fight between Batman and Superman conversations. It was fun to think about, but we never really thought that the people that we were talking about would ever all come together with schedules and everything to be here today. And it was when our top choices agreed, I think we had a mixture of shock, I think we're a little intimidated, and extremely grateful. Our panelists today are people who don't usually appear on panels. They're the people who conference builders build 3-day conferences around their keynote address, and I can't say how grateful and happy I am that they're here to join us today. So let me do my introductions. It's a cliche, but in this case it's true. They really don't need much of an introduction, so I'm not going to give them one. Let me start to my left, Elliot Spitzer, former Attorney General and Governor of the State of New York. Among his many, many accomplishments, but I think what's most relevant for today, he was the so-called Sheriff of Wall Street, using really groundbreaking and innovative prosecutions of Wall Street institutions, as well as individuals, and bringing the use of the Martin Act really into the sort of forefront of the public consciousness as a potential tool for those types of cases. Second, sitting to my right, is Lanny Brewer, who since 2009 and is about to be the longest-serving Assistant Attorney General in the Department of Justice in charge of the Criminal Division in its modern history, where he oversees the Criminal Division's 600 attorneys. I think beyond that, and I don't really recall previous Assistant Attorney Generals sort of having the role that Lanny has had in this administration, and he really has become the go-to guy up on the Hill, I think, for major policy issues dealing with criminal justice, and has really been the face and the spokesperson for our topic today, most recently representing department in interviews on 60 Minutes. And I think that's a real credit to Lanny, and again, so fortunate to have him here. And then finally, to my extreme left, we have Mary Jo White, who's currently a partner and head of litigation at Debevoise and Plimpton, where she seems to represent just about every defendant or institution that has anything to do with any of the financial crisis cases out there.
What can I say to follow that, right?
but far more importantly, from my own personal perspective, before that, for nearly 9 years, she was the United States Attorney for the Southern District of New York, where she had a really an incredible and unprecedented run in that position. And as far as people say, only really making one significant and severe mistake, and that was hiring me in 2000 and giving me the only job I ever wanted and ever would have needed as an assistant United States attorney serving under her. So I should do a couple quick disclosures on that front. I'm heavily conflicted with everyone on this panel since I owe all of them something. Mary Jo, my life and my job. Elliot,
nice.
Elliot was one of my, when I was down in Washington at SIGTARP, was one of my earliest and strongest defenders in the public arena, and is something that I, as I told him earlier today, I'll always be very thankful and grateful for. And Lanny, who I didn't know before I went to Washington, I was fortunate enough to get to know, to become a friend, a confidant, someone who I could pour my heart out in a series of lunches and drinks, and also, as I hope we'll discuss today, Lanny's office brought the most significant case that we brought at SIGTARP, a multi-billion-dollar accounting fraud, that his office led the prosecution. So for that, I'm grateful. So now with all those introductions out of the way, I'm very happy to say that our panelists have graciously agreed to waive the traditional opening statement, and we're going to jump right into the questions. I'm going to moderate a discussion, ask questions until about 1:30 or so, and somebody wave and let me know the time is up, and we'll go to take questions from the audience since we have such a great audience here today. So let me first start with this proposition. First, the president not too long ago, and then the attorney general himself, Holder, in a press conference a little less than 2 weeks ago while announcing a new task force or sub-task force, he offered as part of the explanation of why we haven't seen as many big ticket Wall Street prosecutions, criminal prosecutions, as some would like to see, was because a lot of the potential activity in the run-up to the crisis may have been immoral or unethical, but didn't cross the line to being necessarily criminal behavior that warranted criminal prosecutions. Elliot, I want to start with you. You have not been shy about your criticisms about the lack of prosecutions. You've both on television, and I think really memorable, one of the more memorable appearances in the Academy Award winning film Inside Job. What is your assessment of that statement and that analysis?
Well, it may be accurate, but it's not sufficient. In other words, it is true that much of the activity was immoral, wrong, and not criminal, but that does not then lead to the logical conclusion that much activity was itself not also criminal. There was very significant criminal activity, deception, fraud, in both the civil and the criminal context that should, in fact, be prosecuted. And I continue to believe that if we were to pursue the evidence, and we'll get to maybe a discussion of the Clayton documents later on, as an example of one set of documents that clearly said to the banks, you are securitizing loans that do not satisfy even your own standards, and that information was not disclosed, was not dealt with properly. Those types of documents, if you examined how they radiated out, would lead to criminal cases. Let me make a slightly larger point. I don't want to filibuster, but the larger point is, and I almost hate to bring up Occupy Wall Street, but they had a sign down there that actually was very accurate. It said, "We will know corporations are people when Texas executes one." The problem we have right now is that we have given corporations all the upside, but none of the downside. We have given corporations all the rights and privileges that we extend to individuals, and yet when it comes to holding them accountable, because of the diffusion of responsibility, because of the layers and buffers built in by lawyers, accountants, often investment bankers, all doing their job in good faith, it is very difficult to ascribe criminal intent. And so just as in the financial side, we said, you keep the upside and we'll guarantee you too big to fail on the downside. In the criminal context, we have said, you do bad things, we don't have a way of holding you responsible. Either institutionally, because too big to fail says, we can't indict Goldman Sachs, my goodness, the world will come to an end. So we don't do it. Individually, there's no direct proof of individual intent. And so there is this void. And then, so we're stuck with the downside consequences, and they keep all the upside stuff they want. There's this disequilibrium, and that I think is something we should talk about in terms of remedies. But bottom line, yes, there should be a lot more prosecutions, data, evidence that shows willful disregard for bad acts. Remember, willful disregard for bad stuff is a basis for criminal prosecution. We should be using that theory among many others.
So you mentioned Clayton documents and that there is evidence out there. Why do you think there hasn't been more criminal prosecutions if the evidence is out there?
It's tough, and look, I imagine Lanny or Mary Jo, I don't know who's going to play what appointed role here, will look and say, we also, and I would criticize myself for this as well when I was AG, we didn't bring as many criminal cases as we arguably could have, I would say, but this was earlier on when I fell for the old line of the book, trust me, next time I won't do it. I said, okay, you know, Wall Street perpetrated one of the great scams, the greatest scam they perpetrated was persuading us that they could regulate themselves. Complete hokum. Self-regulation, two words should be stricken from the English language. It doesn't work, never has, never will. We believed it. And so even when we did the analyst settlement, the global settlement, rearranged the entire investment banking world, I gave credence to the notion that they would begin to sort of pull apart the web of conflicts of interest that underlie all the violations of fiduciary duty that lead to the frauds that brought us to where we are.
Lanny, these are your bosses. Do you agree with what they've said?
Well, first let me just comment on some of what Elliot said, and obviously much of what Elliot said makes a lot of sense, but of course even in his answer, he both is addressing policymaking issues. What's the role of regulators? What did the regulators know? Whether or not institutions should regulate themselves and whether or not there should be a change. And those are very important issues, and those are policy issues, and Congress and other legislative entities have to deal with those, but that in and of itself doesn't make it prosecutable. And we just have to remember that. And as I've said before, and I continue to, just as we talk about excessive greed, or we talk about excessive risk-taking, which may be abhorrent, I personally may find it abhorrent. In fact, I do. That in and of itself doesn't make it a crime, and we just have to face that. I also just have to say, I know we're, you know, not that far from Wall Street. I just don't accept the fact that we haven't done anything. I admit that when you're in New York and you're focusing on Wall Street, you may lose sight. But if you look at what's gone on over the last 3 years, we have indicted thousands of people for mortgage-related fraud. We just have. We have indicted and convicted multi-billion-dollar investment fraudsters all over the country. Those are the people who defrauded police officers who put their investments and their pensions in it. Those are the people whose school teachers did it. And it's not just made off here, but throughout the country. Right now, as we're speaking, Alan Stanford in Houston is in trial. My team is there in a $7 billion fraud. So I want to talk about it. I think this is a very important topic, but it's just absolutely not the case to suggest that nothing has been done. We just have to remember that when you bring criminal cases, there are challenges. We absolutely need to bring them, and we do it all the time. And the only other point I would make, of course, which I'd like to think means we're doing it right, in one panel I'm accused of doing too little, and the next panel I'm accused if it's another topic that we're prosecuting too much. And so, look, we just have to call it the way we see it.
No, and I appreciate that, and certainly not to take away from any of the departments, really, I think, some really remarkably good work in these areas, but there still has not been what a lot of people would like to see, which is, you know, handcuffs on senior executives of Wall Street institutions. We've had really our first criminal case that's kind of sort of related in the Southern District of New York this last week, the credit suite.
Well, on that point, look, Elliot made the point there too. Look, we got a room filled with brilliant NYU law students. And some good percentage of these brilliant NYU law students are going to go to these big New York law firms. And you know what? Those big New York law firms were all over these transactions. That's not to say it wasn't criminal. That's not to say we're not investigating it. But we have to deal, as Elliot said, with the lawyers and the disclosure documents. We have to deal with the issue of materiality when you have sophisticated parties and counterparties. You have huge institution, one as a party, you have huge institution, two as the counterparty. I've got to prove materiality. If I can't prove materiality, I've got a problem. And so without going into specific cases, we've got brilliant lawyers. Some hopefully will recruit some of you. We've got great people at the SEC. The SEC, with my dear friend Rob Kuzami, is working tirelessly. But these are very difficult reactions and cases, and the fact that viscerally, we want to see people on Wall Street walking with handcuffs. Frankly, that doesn't do that. I understand the desire, but that's not enough.
So just to follow up, this concept that there's this greed and immorality and stuff that makes us upset but falls short of potentially being the supporting criminal charges, I hear this a lot. Can you give us an example of something like that, and whether or not there's been any consideration of expanding the criminal laws to cover these types of behaviors? You know, really, when we're talking about the criminal law, we're talking about unethical behavior, and we've chosen as a society, right, to draw a line and say everything on this side that we think is unethical will be punishable by the criminal statutes, and anything on this side we think is bad but maybe should be done civilly, right, or something less. So I guess the two-part question is, can you give us an example of something that falls on the non-criminal side of the line, and whether there's any movement or suggestion to move that line to try to include this behavior? Because if this is the behavior that helped cause this remarkable collapse of our near collapse of our financial system, Right. Shouldn't it be criminal so we can make sure it doesn't happen again?
Well, look, I'll leave it to others to decide as a policymaking level what ought to be criminal. And I want to be clear, nothing that I'm saying is to suggest we're not bringing cases, we're not investigating cases. Of course, the Southern District just announced a Credit Suisse case just a week or so ago. There are a lot of cases actively being investigated, and you need to know it. But look, at the end of the day, I have to prove every element of a crime beyond a reasonable doubt. I've got to prove that it's material. I've got to prove that people acted with criminal intent. Now, if you want to say there ought to be strict liability, but when we're talking about these cases, there is no secret here. We had a downfall and we had a financial crisis, but during the time, as Elliot said, as a country, this country embraced some level of regulatory action and not more. People embraced the idea of securitizations and more complex products. For a long time, we put those people on a pedestal. They were the smart people who stopped going to law firms and went on and created these structures and became gazillionaires, right? And they own their big houses all over New York. I mean, you all know that. Now, suddenly,
that's
we're
mad. It's got to be a crime, don't you think?
Right. Exactly. Right.
Now we're talking.
So when we talk about it, the problem I have is, right, everybody, when you're a company or you're an individual and you have, you know, the greatest of the great lawyers like Mary Jo White, you know, they're going to put us to our test, and we just have to prove the case. And by the way, we're doing it. It just, these are, as Ellie said, they're very complicated. Companies are big. Decision-making is diffuse. Documents are, they're many-fold. They're millions of documents. We are putting the time in. We will continue to. I've said we're absolutely committed, as we have been. As I said, we've brought a lot of cases, maybe not. We keep changing a little bit the focus. I think if 3 years ago we were on the panel and I would have told you that we had prosecuted dozens and dozens of people who had done billion-dollar frauds, people have said that sounds pretty good. We've now decided to take those billion-dollar investment fraudsters and put them in one category and say, let's not talk about them, let's talk about this. And we're doing it all, but that's a challenge.
Topic of our conversation today, though, is that that's all I. But that certainly is not to take away from those very important cases. Mary Jo, you probably have one of the most fascinating perspectives of all of this, having truly been on both sides in a way that I think there's probably no person in the country has been on both sides, as the U.S. attorney and in your current role. What do you think about the president's assessment? And I'm going to take it that you probably don't think that we should be changing the laws in reaction to that. But I'd like to get your response to both of those questions.
Well, I mean, I think the breadth of the criminal laws, both state and federal, and in the securities fraud arena in particular, are extraordinarily broad. I mean, they pick up every variety of fraud that you can imagine, and you can actually bring a criminal case based on real live criminal intent. I'm intending to defraud whomever. You can bring it if you consciously avoid facts that amount to a fraud. So the laws are extraordinarily broad. They're awesome, awesome powers before you bring a criminal case against either a company, which is frankly quite easy to do as a legal matter. If one employee, however low down the organization, has committed a crime, the company is actually criminally liable for that. Doesn't mean prosecutors therefore should prosecute companies and drive them out of business. Arthur Anderson is sort of exhibit A of, you know, a misfiring of the prosecutorial powers, I think. Like anytime you've got a financial crisis of the unprecedented dimension and scope of what we've been going through, you're going to have crimes being committed. You know, people aren't sort of used to that kind of colossal failure, and you can have people who don't mark to market deliberately, and so you should be aggressive where there is crime. But what you should not do is fail to distinguish between what is actually criminal and what is just mistaken behavior, what is even reckless risk-taking, and not bow to the frenzy. I mean, what I worry about the most is, you know, you saw during the height of the crisis, every CEO of any financial institution sort of on the cable networks as if they were on the most, you know, 10 most wanted list, you know, with marks across them or not across them. Forget whether they committed a crime, forget whether there's any evidence whatsoever they even had any knowledge of a fraud, forget whether there may have been absolutely no crime committed in the case of their companies by anyone. And so we must distinguish between conduct that isn't criminal and what is criminal. And I, you know, Lanny, I'll applaud that other panel you were on where they were beating you up for bringing too many cases. But seriously, I mean, I think you have to proceed responsibly here and not bow to the frenzy. And I worry that the frenzy, you know, overtakes, you know, reason and judgment sometimes.
Two things. First, I want to know who was on that panel with you who was taking that position. That's kind of shocking.
Probably me, but actually.
You are, there you go. All right.
Well, no.
Let me say this. I think, Mary Jo, you're obviously right. Anybody who's been to law school knows there's that spectrum of intent, and that where the civil law morphs into criminal law is something of a debate, philosophical, moral, whatever. But I think the pressure to bring criminal cases would have and could have abated had there been more significant remedies brought even when the cases were civil. And I'll give you an example. The Abacus case, the famous Goldman case where they were selling securitized debt to people knowing it was going to tank, betting against it, knowingly having put together this product, intending that it fail. And Goldman had to pay the whopping fee of $500 million, which was basically the sales tax on its $12.9 billion check from taxpayers that it got for its exposure to AIG credit default swaps. You know, it was a cost of doing business. They said, fine, here's the $500 million back. We keep $12.4 billion. We win, and we get to continue to do these types of things. At the time of that settlement, why wasn't it necessarily imposed upon them? Because this was a business model, that they change the way they structure these deals. Citi has done it. Goldman has done it. There's good reason to believe that each of the banks knew at the time it was structuring these deals what it was doing, and so use the remedial opportunity in the civil setting to get the structural reform you need, and then maybe the pressure just to have a CEO in handcuffs would have diminished.
I mean, I think there's something to be said for that, a lot to be said for that, but I also think there's a real pitfall, and that is when you have prosecutors, as great as we all were when we were prosecutors, or are prosecutors, you know, to try to delve into areas where you really don't have the expertise to deal with it. I mean, one of the major efforts and achievements of your office, Elliot, I think, was the research analyst settlement. You know, there are different views as to whether that, you know, was good or bad in the long run, you know, for the public interest. But I think you have to be very careful legislating reform by way of enforcement actions. I mean, you have to be right about that. You have to be expert about that. But I agree that if you actually dealt with what you consider to be the kind of transaction, the way it was structured that caused so many losses, you know, that could abate the cry for scalps and handcuffs. Yeah.
Look, Mary Jo, you're absolutely right. Where you change, and Lanny alluded to this a few moments ago, I mean, Lanny is very meticulous in saying, look, I'm here as the prosecutor. I'm not the policy decision maker. That's a legislative function. That's right. Having said that, the role of prosecutors these days, where you have had massive regulatory failure at the SEC, the OCC, the FDIC, on and on and on down, where nobody is enforcing basic rules of fiduciary obligation in the marketplace, prosecutors legitimately, in my view, can say this case is Exhibit A, an exemplar of how your business model is broken, and if you want out from under this prosecution, then you must change the way you do business to ensure that you will not go back to doing it again. You catch a guy selling a bit of cocaine the second time, he's away for 20 years. We have seen the major banks as recidivists over and over again, precisely because the penalties imposed upon them are not sufficient to get them to change what they do.
I think you're presuming more knowledge and expertise on the part of the prosecutors, though. I mean, you do have, Lanny, you go ahead and talk about this. I mean, you do have the option of a deferred prosecution agreement or a non-prosecution agreement against a company, mm-hmm. where you can impose any condition you want to that the company will agree to. If you're certain about a broken business model, you know, and I would question whether you are and know enough to be certain of it, you know, you could require that as a condition.
Yeah, I was just going to.
I might know enough to do that, but, you know.
Well.
you know, just to follow up on that comment, look, I don't want to suggest for a moment that our prosecutors are taking a myopic view. And of course, Elliot, you're right. If you're involved in a case and you see a systemic problem in trying to resolve the case, you try, if you can, in an appropriate way to deal with it. And my point of saying the role of the prosecutor, I was just saying to the degree we're going to empower our regulators more. That's not something that the prosecutors themselves can do. Now, as the head of the criminal division, I, unlike a U.S. attorney, don't have a civil piece. So, right? Okay. So in a lot of these settlements, it's either the Southern District of New York, or it's been the SEC, or it's been them combined. I just want to say that, you know, it's easy on a panel to talk about what more should have been, you know, part of a settlement, but No one accuses my friend Preet Bharara, and no one's accused my friend Rob Kuzami of being naturally hesitant people. They are aggressive, and appropriately so. And so, look, in each deal, and I don't want to talk about abacus or anyone because I actually don't know the facts of it. What I do know is that people are working hard and they're pretty damn tough. And so I think in any settlement with a company on the other side, you know, there's a give and a take. And so I can't address why something wasn't done in the case, but what I can say from my interactions is that if it wasn't done, it was because in the strength of that particular case, and these are complicated cases, and I know it's not fun to hear it, with lots of disclosures, lots of conditions, lots of other issues, and these settlements have been a result of that. And they've been aggressive settlements, but I think you have to keep that in mind.
Well, Lenny, I think that at least as of the last couple of weeks, one potential source of criticism, I think, of the department's response has been generated by the department itself, and that is the creation now in 2012 of a brand new sub-task force within the Financial Fraud Enforcement Task Force that's dedicated to, I think, origination and securitization fraud that contributed to the crisis. Now, this, of course, arises out of the Financial Fraud and Enforcement Task Force, of which I was fortunate enough to be a charter member along with you back in 2009 when it was launched, which this sounds a lot like, which also sounds a lot like President Bush's Financial Fraud Task Force, I forget what it's called, the working group, of which I was, I think, the final member of back in years before that. So, you know, we have these sort of evolving structures, and this one comes out, and at least one way to do it is an acknowledgement from the department that its approach up until this point, you know, hasn't been optimal and hasn't captured the types of cases that they want. Now, the other side of this, and many skeptics, including myself, to be honest, look at the structure of this new working group. It's co-chaired not just by you, but by the New York State Attorney General Schneiderman, as being more of a political rebranding in an election year on a potential issue that's unpopular. It's the president's vulnerable with his base on,
right.
And whether or not this is just a political rebranding of an existing effort, or is it an acknowledgement that something's been broken needs to be fixed?
I don't think it's either. Look, there is no magic. There's no magic to these names or these structures. You've got a lot of well-intentioned people who are trying to deal with these issues. And Neil, when you and I were on the working group together in the task force, we were trying to figure out as effectively as we could within this large structure how we could make a real difference. And as you pointed out, and I'm very proud of it, through that task force, we got together and we brought the Farkas case, and it was very successful. This is an iterative process. We're in a time, of course, of fiscal constraints. We're in a time where the nation has expressed appropriately so a level of outrage of this conduct. We have local and state prosecutors who want to be involved. Elliot and I were in the Manhattan DA's office together. And so what this really is, it's an evolutionary process. The fact that we are now doing this suggests that we have more AGs than ever before who want to be helpful. Because of this task force, I spent 2 days with Eric Schneiderman. Without the task force, candidly, I probably wouldn't have. I spent yesterday all day at the SEC, and we talked about these issues. So the fact that it's evolutionary, the fact that we now have a structure just focusing on this, doesn't suggest that what we hadn't done isn't working. What it does suggest is that we keep trying to figure out ways of being more nimble, ways of getting more resources together. This will be far more operational. And so I think what it does suggest is we don't pretend we have every answer. We don't pretend that there's only one way to do it, but it does indicate that I am, and many of us are extraordinarily committed to holding people responsible.
But there was a state attorney general component to the original financial fraud enforcement.
Yeah, but what there wasn't, right? We used to
talk. They were co-chair, but.
Yeah, well, but what there wasn't, right? There wasn't as much of an operational point where people were actually detailing individuals to work together. So you and I built a good relationship because we're friendly, and so our teams could work together, but in this case more than before, and I think before people probably wouldn't have done it quite as well. Now people are working literally under the same roof, and frankly, you know, we've all learned a lot. So now I get to see what does the New York AG have going on? What is the SEC doing? It's just another way of figuring out what are the different offices around the country, and there are a lot of offices handling this.
Let me just ask you a two-part follow-up. First of all, isn't this a little bit late? I mean, aren't we running up against the five-year statute of limitations for these cases? I mean, where most of the securitization that occurred by 2000, right. You know, 5 years is 2007. By that time, this machine was grinding to a halt, not sort of taking off. So my first part of my question is this a little bit too late?
Right.
And I think one of the things that's been suggested, which suggests, and you haven't convinced me yet, that this is not more of a political reaction, is also who's on this and running this working group and who's not. We have Eric Schneiderman, who has been very vocal in this field for sure. But what you're missing is as you mentioned before, Preparara and the Southern District of New York, and I have parochial issues as an alum, but I just went to the celebration of 50 years of having a securities fraud unit, oldest in the country, the most resources, I think, probably dedicated exclusively to securities fraud with more than 25
right.
prosecutors. And so what does it say about this conference that not only is the Southern District not on the sort of co-chairs, but my understanding is that they're not on the committee, and you know, what does that say about this group? So that's my two-part question.
Well, first, the fact that you don't have the august title like I do of being one of the co-chairs of the work committee or the working group doesn't suggest, and you know this, that you're not involved. Preet is obviously a leader in this space. The Southern District is obviously a leader in this space and will continue to be. And I know he's heartbroken that there are a couple of meetings in Washington that he doesn't have to attend, but, you know, I think that conflicted with posing for his portrait in Time magazine, and we just couldn't get the two together. So look.
He is the man who busted Wall Street.
So look, the Southern District is very involved. With respect to the statute of limitations, look, a lot of these investigations are ongoing. There are plenty of statutes out there, and that's actually the idea, right? FIREA has a 10-year statute of limitations. So we have lots of tools. The states have tools. Of course, in New York, Elliot is the most expert. It's a Martin Act, but lots of AGs have tools. So, I mean, there are different ways of getting around this. And I guess my answer is people have been spending a lot of time, but I don't want to suggest that because in 2012 we're still at it, that we weren't at it in 2009, 10, and 11. And we're going to continue to be at it for a number of years to come.
Mary Jo, back in 2008, you had some statements sort of, and I think you alluded to this in your opening comments earlier, about task force and sort of the downsides of creating these types of task force, especially in a highly politicized environment, which this certainly is. And if please correct me if I'm wrong, if my recollection is correct, you made a mention to Arthur Anderson when you were U.S. attorney, and they were putting around together the Enron task force. I think that perhaps it was under you that made the decision the Southern District was not going to participate in that particular task force. So I'd like for you, if you could, to address the potential dangers of this approach, and if I could tie you back to what you said earlier, whether Enron task forces may be an example of how some of those dangers could be expressed.
Well, I mean, I think, you know, speaking generically of task forces, I guess my immediate reaction to task forces that are announced with a lot of fanfare in press is, so where's the meat, I guess, as the former, you know, the old expression goes. I mean, you know, are they real is the first question that you ask. You ask, weren't there two others already? And then you wonder what is new now. So that's kind of on one side. You wonder whether they really are more than just a mechanism to, you know, try to assure the public you're doing something, announce cases when you bring them as a press matter, or are they really bringing together resources that it's helpful to bring together to actually do the job. The other concern I have about task forces, not saying that you can't have some task force that doesn't make sense to have and do good things from an enforcement point of view, but it's kind of like, you know, announce it and there will be cases. It gets back into my, you know, frenzy concern. It gets back into my, you know, once you form a body like that, much like a special prosecutor, you know, may be anointed, they're a failure if they therefore don't bring criminal cases. You don't want that in the system. You don't want that kind of pressure in the system. You don't want the search for scalps to be, you know, that's our metric of success. I mean, you really want those cases investigated thoroughly, aggressively, but really decided on the merits. Politics doesn't belong in this space at all, but it sure is in the space.
And do you think Enron was sort of an example of that? I think I heard from someone recently that there were 30 individuals charged plus Arthur Anderson, and I think of All of them, only one survived. Of those who went to trial, only one survived appeal. That might be completely off.
I could say something like, I rest my case. But just as a historical matter, I actually was U.S. attorney. I actually opened the Enron investigation, not for a task force, but in the Southern District of New York office. And then after I left, the task force, I think, was formed, and the Southern District decided not to participate in that. You have to ask others why that was, but I mean, the Southern District is never, you know, it's known not so fondly, as some of you know, as the sovereign district of New York.
I think it's fondly.
And not so fondly, but, you know, they will, you know, make judgments based on where, you know, where do they get the biggest bang for the buck. That often is in their judgment. You know, they operate on their own. They supplement a task force. They're not necessarily a part of one, not out of protest, not out of being left out, but because they think they actually can get more traction doing the work as they've historically done it as a sovereign. I think Elliot knows something about New York's sovereignty working alone, too. You can get a lot done.
Yeah, indeed. Well, look, can I just jump in? I think Mary Jo's right about this. Creating new task forces, it's great press. It doesn't do anything. Where's the beef? Where are the cases? That's all that matters. That's the bottom line measure, and those should be evaluated on their own merits. I think where we continue to disagree a little bit, and I think Lanny's right. Look, I just want to make it clear. The folks who are in the federal government, they work hard. They're incredibly smart, diligent. None of this is personal attacks upon quality skill sets of the prosecutors involved. These are judgment calls about scope and elasticity of criminal and civil statutes and the degree to which they should and should not be used. But I'll give you a real-life example where this is SEC, not the U.S. attorney, so you're going to say, okay, right, that was civil jurisdiction, but we had a whole raft of cases. And Mary Jo, I think your firm was involved in a fair number of them. A lot of your partners are sending their kids to college on fees from this, they're, or law school, as it may be. They, you know, mutual.
That's not all bad either, right?
The mutual fund industry was doing a lot of bad stuff because of a structural issue where there were conflicts of interest in terms of boards, interlocking boards, et cetera. One manifestation of it was the particular civil criminal stuff we saw. Another manifestation of it was fees that were being pushed back onto ordinary investors improperly, we felt. The SEC didn't feel that negotiating the fees back down to where the market would have pushed them was an appropriate exercise of jurisdiction. We clearly did, saved, I think, billions and billions of dollars for investors. Bizarrely, as this issue percolated through in a slightly different context, Judge Posner, of all people, you know, not exactly one to see expansive judicial prosecutorial power, has agreed with us with respect to specifically mutual fund fees, CEO compensation, where he said where the fiduciary obligations are so fundamentally broken, it is appropriate for judicial and hence prosecutorial intervention. So I think that's where you can begin to see smart prosecutions and remedies that address these issues in a more substantive and also publicly satisfying way.
And Ellie, I totally agree with you. And I just want to make a point on what both you have said and what Mary Jo said, because I completely agree. Look, you know, in a former life, I had to deal with independent counsels when I was special counsel to President Clinton. I've always been publicly very critical of independent counsels for the very reason that Mary Jo said. But if you even follow the flow of our discussion today, it's on the one hand, we haven't done enough, and on the other hand, task forces are too aggressive. And what I'd say is you can get it right. I mean, I'm not going to comment one way or the other on the Enron task force. I defended people in that case, but with respect to this task force, the whole point is to get it right. It's to promote the very dialogue, Elliot, you're talking about. We don't have it all right. And whatever you call it, if this new residential mortgage-backed securities working group permits me to have more discussions with Kamala Harris or with Eric Schneiderman or with Beau Biden or with others who are saying, you know, we have more flexibility or we should be more elastic, I think that's right. I think it's on us not to bow to political pressure and to prosecute just for prosecution's sake, but I think it's incumbent upon us to have as comprehensive approach as we can with local, state, and federal people so that we get it right. And that's the goal of this, been the goal.
Can I jump in there? Let me ask you about these Clayton documents. And I don't know if anybody here has seen them. I've seen them marginally. Fellow Josh Rosner, who's an investment banker for a fair number of years, was speaking out very aggressively saying, we have an impending crisis. And then at a certain point in time, these documents became public. I think it was through the FCIC, Phil Angelides' commission out, which I thought produced a very fine document. These Clayton documents, and correct me if I mischaracterize them, essentially say that the very company that was brought in by the banks to do due diligence on the underlying creditworthiness of the underlying mortgages found and told the banks, these loans do not satisfy your own underwriting standards, 30-40% of them. The banks then took those mortgages and securitized them nonetheless. Now, that seems to me, and I haven't followed every email and every how, but I always believed you get into the bowels of a bank
by going
through the credit department.
Right.
You follow this stuff up and find out exactly where that information goes. How can you not then make a structural case against the banks for failing to act with their fiduciary obligations with that information?
I mean, look, I can't talk about Clayton because, as you may or may not know, I mean, Angelides did, in fact, refer to the criminal division and to the department, the referrals. I've dealt with him. And so I obviously can't talk about anything that could be under active investigation.
Can you give us a date? I'm just kidding.
But obviously, that wasn't that funny. But, you know, look, in all of these kinds of cases, and Elliot, you make a good point, but look, in all of these cases, it comes down to what exactly was represented, what was actually understood, what did the acquirer understand they were getting. If there was a misrepresentation, did the acquirer, the counterparty, rely on the misrepresentation? Or did they know, and I hate to say it, and this sometimes happens, did they think, you know what, they're BSing me. They're saying this, but we have our own people who are pretty damn smart, and we have our own people to determine what the underlying securities are that we're going to acquire. So was there any reliance on it at all? So there are just many, many issues that we have to pour through in all of these cases. And obviously, I'm not going to talk about any particular one. I'm just saying they're very, you know, as everybody here knows, they're very labor-intensive exercises.
Can I just jump in for 1 second? Something Elliot said that I think is absolutely right. And I think there's a recognition on the part of prosecutors and government attorneys kind of across the country that this is so, and that is that you often can accomplish a lot more on the civil side in the way of reforms and in the way of bringing viable, you know, large cases in this space. So the Southern District of New York, for example, has formed a civil fraud, you know, unit, not task force, in its civil division. And so in the pharmaceutical space, I mean, you have a lot, you know, False Claims Act cases being brought. You have corporate integrity agreements as part of, you know, those resolutions. And so, and you don't have the consequence of a criminal indictment driving the fifth of the big five, now the big four accounting firms out of business. So, I mean, it's well worth spending a lot of time on that, I think, as a government, a series of governments.
But let me just raise sort of a counterposition here. One of the problems of the civil abuse of civil authorities, and I think we've seen this a lot in the financial crisis space, is that you have judgments, which Judge Rakoff likes to refer to as pocket change or change from underneath the cushions of the sofa, against these institutions on the very, very rare occasions that you see individuals charged in these cases. Their fees or penalties or settlements appear to be covered by either insurance policies or the shareholders themselves. Reimbursement, we saw that in the WaMu case most recently. And it sort of raises the question of one of the reasons why, you know, we all got into the business of being prosecutors and why, I think I'm speaking for all of us, we like doing the big cases is not just because of all that good publicity, but because of the impact you have through deterrence. And the sense that I get from a lot of these cases is that while they may be helping, you know, good, valuable, important goals, are they really going to get us to the point of deterrence of showing that this type of activity doesn't pay off for the individual who took home the huge bonuses, who profited richly, and got to keep just about every single penny? Like, how do we fill that gap?
Well, the threshold question is, did that individual commit a crime?
Or even civilly, though.
And secondly, you know, even if so, arguably, is it a case that's appropriate to, you know, bring a criminal prosecution against? But what you're saying is either, I mean, like, deterrence is kind of the name of the game, particularly in the white-collar arena. I think it's probably the one place where deterrence actually works. And I think when you do arrests on Wall Street, everybody on Wall Street knows about that. And I think at least in the short term, there is a deterrent effect. But as I always used to say to assistants in the office, you know, pay attention to that vehicle of deterrence you're about to charge, should that person actually be charged. Don't just jump to the, gee, this would be deterrent for not only this individual, punishment for this individual, but deterrent for the next, you know, for people similarly situated. I mean, plainly, you know, we did a lot of cases in the securities fraud unit on the criminal side after the SEC had brought one or two or three, you know, civil actions, and the guy didn't get it. He was a recidivist, and so you needed, you know, a bigger hammer. And so you do need to pay a lot of attention to that. And you see in the Justice Department and in the SEC and a lot of arenas, the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act being one, you know, making a specific point of saying we really are appropriately but targeting individuals for that very reason.
I think this raises the structural issue that I tried to raise at the beginning of, which is this tension between, you're right, the standard and the threshold for criminal action is necessarily and rightly very high. Specific intent, real intent, whichever theory you're using in the particular case. On the other hand, when you bring civil cases and the company pays a little bit of money, there is no deterrence. I think we can accept. For Goldman, the $500 million was, who cares? The reality is we need to figure out a better way to enforce and to create deterrence in a context where there may not be sufficient evidence to get prove intent, actual intent, against the CEO. And it's always struck me that that is where creative use of civil remedies comes in. Why didn't they say to Goldman, you know what, you were prescribed from doing transactions of this sort for 10 years. The five people who are up in line, even though there may not be direct evidence of their culpability, they're barred from the industry for 10 years because we've got to create an environment where people understand management responsibility carries a burden. Why was not the CEO of any of the banks removed at the point in time where they were selling and securitizing junk that they should have known was junk, even if you can't prove a criminal case? In other words, to say, this is why I say the Occupy Wall Street sign was right. We're giving them all the rights and none of the downside risks and liabilities. And so I think there's a way to craft genuine remedies in the middle there that will say to people up at the top, you will be held accountable. There is a price to be paid.
Well, I mean, I think you're getting remedies like that with, you know, the clawback remedies, under Sarbanes-Oxley. I mean, the SEC is beginning to be very active in that space. But there are a lot of assumptions in your scenario that need to be proven. Another day we'll do that one. But I mean, what did the CEO know? Is it so clear these transactions, you know, as structured are bad? You know, per se. I mean, you know, that it takes a lot of knowledge to know that, a lot of expertise to know that, and a lot of chutzpah to decree that, you know, you can't be in that business. I mean, one example of where that was done as part of a criminal alternative resolution, I think, was in the KPMG Deferred Prosecution Agreement, which essentially, as part of that, really that firm had to go out of the tax shelter business. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you know, there are available remedies, but I think we got to be real careful about thinking we know enough as prosecutors and enforcement people to decree them.
I also just for a moment, and look, I want to be clear. I don't want to suggest for a moment that we don't, and we will aggressively pursue cases criminally. But I guess both as a defense lawyer, which I was for many years, a white-collar defense lawyer, and now as an AAG, I don't think we should completely discount the deterrent effect when we investigate cases, even if we don't bring them. If a CEO or a CFO of a major institution feels that he or she is subject to criminal liability, when we interview them or we put them in the grand jury or they have lawyers and this is hanging over their heads for years and years, it may be at the end we decide not to prosecute the company or the individual. But I think it's really inaccurate to suggest that that doesn't have a very strong effect. And I'm not sure CEOs on Wall Street right now feel as if that they can do whatever they want and there's no deterrence. I mean, certainly around the country and certainly when I meet with CEOs, certainly in a whole array of industries, I'm told something quite different.
Let me just shift gears for a second because I think this is sort of underlying, I think, how I would answer your rhetorical questions, Elliot, about why didn't we see more structural change? I think in the Goldman Sachs example of Abacus is that if the SEC had probably insisted on those terms, Goldman wouldn't have settled. And that reminded me of the second part of your question, which is why when we were bailing, I think it was implicit, why when we were bailing the banks out, did we not insist on more punitive measures against the financial institutions that were the too big to fail banks that were coming to the till? And in a very, if you excuse me, my tortured transition a little bit longer, in part of that, I think some have said, is because of the revolving door between the financial regulators and Wall Street. Particularly, in Treasury is a great example of many people who go back and forth from the banks to the regulators and then back again, which tends to lead towards agency capture and at least a lack of diversity of views. And that may seem far afield from our topic, but let me continue. It has also been suggested, however, that this revolving door in our sphere, in criminal justice, many people have pointed to that as one of the explanations as to why there have not been more robust criminal law enforcement, and two of our panelists have been the subject of really those types of press inquiries. And to disclose, I was a defense lawyer for 5 years. I think it made me a much better prosecutor, and frankly, a more fierce prosecutor than I had not had the experience of representing guilty people. I think as a prosecutor, you get to...
Do your clients know you just said that?
They it was a long time ago, and they wouldn't be surprised.
I don't think they'd be happy either, though.
Every now and then it happens, but it's a broken clock twice a day type of thing. But but specifically, Mary Jo, you were in a Rolling Stone piece. I think Preet described you as the Dr. Frankenstein, who created.
I've been called worse, actually.
who spawned both him and Rob Ghazami? And although I escaped mention, I like to think of myself as one of the offspring. And the sense that. Just today, we were on the New York Times, my very, very good close friend who's leaving the securities unit with a seven-figure payday at one of the big firms.
He said jealously. But
I talk Chris everything he knows. But in all seriousness, what do you make of this criticism? I know you don't agree with it. I frankly don't agree with it either. But what do you say about the optics of it that are at least out there that are causing some people to sort of question the integrity of our system?
Yeah, I think the optics, are an issue. I mean, it raises sort of the questions. If it's sort of reasoning backwards. I mean, if you think somebody has gotten a, slap on the wrist when they should have been treated much more vigorously, and you find out that, the lawyers on each side know each other from prior days in the government or prior days in the private sector, aha, that must be it. I don't buy it at all. I mean, I think it's, you have to be cognizant of those appearances and deal with those so you don't undermine, the appearance of, even though the reality's there, of even-handed justice and so forth. But I mean, we've all been in the government. We all, obviously clients sometimes think, well, gee, so-and-so, or you, if you're like me, you were U.S. attorney for so long, you've hired everybody, right? So it's sort of like, and if you know somebody, you're going to get a better result. I mean, I think, if anything, the opposite is the case. I mean, you don't get a better result because you were a former friend of a friend. And I frankly think the system is benefited by knowledgeable lawyers in the private sector who have been in the government and vice versa. I mean, one of the things when I was hiring young assistant United States attorneys I most liked to see was somebody who'd been on the defense side and been beaten up and on the short end of the stick of what they considered to be overzealous prosecutors. That's not to say it doesn't help you in the private sector to have been at the SEC or DOJ or a state attorney general's office. You understand how they think. You understand what's persuasive. But there's nothing wrong in that. And indeed, I think it makes the system stronger.
Lanny, do you want to comment? You were sort of been on the receiving end of this.
Sure.
As well.
Yeah. No. Look. I mean, not.
I think unfairly for.
Yeah. I mean, look. First of all, the system is a great system, and most of the prosecutors are career prosecutors around the country. But I do think having people go in and out of government is great. It makes us more flexible. It makes us more nimble. There's just no question in my own mind that I'm a far better AAG because for 10 years I litigated against some of the sections, candidly, that I now supervise. I had a much better sense of what large firms are able to do in big, sophisticated cases. I was able to look at cases from a defense perspective and try to identify what the government needed to do. And frankly, I think having both career prosecutors and people inside and out just generates the kinds of ideas that Elliot was speaking about. I travel around the world, and I deal with my counterparts all over the world. And in many societies, of course, going in and out is not what they do. People stay in the government their whole careers. In fact, they take a different path out of law school if you're going to serve in the government than in the private sector. And there's just no question, as a result of that, in a lot of countries in the world, they're less innovative and they're and they're far less able to deal with the situation. So I think one of the majesty of our system is that we have people, great, bright people who are making a lot of money in firms and who then want to serve in the government for a while, and then vice versa. And so I think it would be terrible for that to be sacrificed.
Elliot, let me phrase this to you with a little bit of a setup, because I really want to get your thoughts on this. I think like me, that you agree that capture and the revolving door in some of the financial regulators has been a problem. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I think you
just did that, but that's okay.
tell me if you disagree with that. But I do. I actually think it's been a significant problem in my time at Treasury. I felt I really saw the impact of the revolving door in Treasury. Yet, for the same reason, I'm much less bothered by this in prosecutions. And my wife is a psychologist, and she could sort of give a fancy term for that. Mary Jo, I know I learned today that you studied a year of psychology before going to law school, and you could, you know, that may be my own distorted view from my own experiences. But part of it, I think the reason why I think that as lawyers in law school and when we get out, we're sort of trained to represent our client. And I think that gives us a degree of flexibility to go from side to side with a little bit more than somebody who is a banker. From a regulatory perspective, I really like to get your thoughts on this issue.
Well, look, I see it a little bit differently. I mean, I agree with Mary Jo. Actually, I think the revolving door at some level can be good because you get, and you have each said this, you get more diverse perspectives. You have nimble intellects, people who are willing to play many different roles, and that can be very good and important. The problem is not whether somebody has been at a big firm and then becomes a prosecutor and somehow they're tainted. The question is, have they so internalized their arguments, the ones they made while they were at the big firm, that they find it incapable of understanding their new position? And I'll give you an example, and I hate to personalize this, but you know, I still like to think I can get along fine with Harvey Pitt. When Harvey Pitt, who had been a great securities defense lawyer, became the chairman of the SEC, he said to the industry that appeared before him for a speech, he said, "You're going to see a kinder, gentler SEC." And I said, "I don't want a kind and gentle SEC. I want a mean, tough, vigorous, aggressive SEC with judgment, but not kind and gentle." And I think Harvey had internalized the defenses he had been making, and so he perhaps had neutered himself and made it impossible to make the sorts of judgments that needed to be made. That's a different issue. I think Mary Jo and Lanny are right, and you as well. Getting diverse views is fine. Now, the problem we have that I've seen at Treasury and elsewhere is not a revolving door issue per se. It's what I call the Peter Principle on steroids. We promoted the wrong people. In other words, we took the people who had made egregiously bad decisions that led to the crisis, and we said, "Gee, you must have learned something because you created such a mess. Now you're in charge of solving it." And, you know, for the life of me, I didn't quite understand why we would put the same mechanics who had broken the engine for the past 10 years, who should have known to change the oil or slow down, you know, whatever needed to be slowed down, and say, "Hey, go in and speed it up again." That is a slightly different issue than a revolving door issue. It's just, you know, look, we all know the Peter Principle, and it's just got worse and worse, in my view.
You have no idea. With that, I think it's time now to take questions from the audience. Do we have a microphone or a question, designated question? Oh, there we go. We have a microphone. Barry up front.
Sure. Hi, my name is Barry Ritholtz. So one of the things that strikes me about the lack of prosecutions in terms of easy prosecutions is what's been going on with the robo-signers. So somewhere between Jamie Dimon and the $8 burger flipper who was hired to sign 100 documents an hour, he fills out a form and says, "I've reviewed these documents in this file," when he hasn't. "I've seen the note," when he hasn't. "I know it's this sort of delay in payment, and here's the last payment," when he hasn't verified it, and on, there are 10 or 20 data points that they verify, which they haven't. They sign it, they get it notarized, or at least in half the cases, it's a false notary. They just are stamping it and signing it, not by a notary, and then that's submitted to a court. When I went to law school, we called that perjury, and I have a hard time imagining that there isn't a 1L in this building that wouldn't run a 90% successful prosecution rate on those cases. And so when the public is frustrated with a lack of prosecution, the question is, why aren't we figuring out, just the way you roll a guy selling a nickel bag to get to the drug pin, who decided that the law doesn't matter and the rules of property, which have been around for literally centuries, don't matter, and they ordered, let's just do this down and dirty. Why aren't those being prosecuted everywhere this sort of robo-signing has taken place?
Well, do you want to take this? I mean, I think sure. This is sort of the low-hanging fruit.
Yeah. So I'm detecting a point of view in that question. well, first of all, let me just say, I'm not going to talk about robo. I can't talk about robo-signing. I mean, obviously, in the press, they're talking about different ways of settling it. But let me suggest a couple of points. One, don't assume that in a lot of areas that prosecutions aren't being made. And indeed, if you use some of examples, and again, it's hard to answer your question because I can't and won't talk about robo-signing, but you are not. I mean, those are the kinds of cases, candidly, for the most part, that cases like that, you're going to get pretty low-level people. Now, yes, you can try to work your way up, but there have been tons of those cases. There are tons of people. There are tons of lawyers and accountants and brokers who are in jail. In Nevada, we've had a series of cases of major frauds on home associations. So my point isn't to take away from your question, but I really do don't accept the premise, one, that it hasn't happened, because at the same time we're saying, how come you're not indicting the CEOs of major institutions, we're also talking about something like robo-signing. Those are fairly different concepts. I understand the concept of going up, but it a little bit hits the point, it's just visceral. We want to get people, and we're not sure exactly where it is. So robo-signing is one issue, and putting aside, there may be the fraud, as you describe, of making a representation that you didn't. But of course, there are those who will talk about whether or not, well, I better be careful what I say in that, but you do have to be careful and
come on.
Now, you know, what is the substantive violation? Is it a process violation, which is terrible, that somebody processed tens of thousands of things and robo-signed or did something else, and maybe there's an argument it would have happened in any event. My only point to you is that lots of low-hanging fruit, lots of mid-hanging fruit, and I would say a fair bit of sophisticated cases have been brought. I don't think we do as good a job of explaining it. And then more generally, I'd say you shouldn't assume, and I think that I have to be careful, but obviously Pre just announced Credit Suisse. There are lots of cases where, in fact, we are working our way up.
Okay. Where's our man with the mic? We'll go here in the front row.
Hi, I'm Chris. I'm a 3L. I know a lot of what people are angry about is what appears to be a hypocrisy as far as prosecuting rich people for crimes as opposed to poor people. And Mr. Brewer, I think in a couple times you mentioned how good the lawyers are for executives and how they can hire good counsel. And I was wondering how much that should or can or does play a role in prosecute in your use of discretion as opposed to just letting it affect the outcome at trial.
It's a great question. So look, I mean, you know, I testify about things like the crack powder cocaine disparities. Under my watch, I'm proud to say we've had the largest organized crime takedowns in the history of the country. We pursue Medicare fraudsters all over. And there's just no question that, and we do gangs, right? Gang prosecutions are a huge priority. There's just no question that in our society, different people have different quality of representation. And anyone to suggest differently is being disingenuous. It doesn't at all affect our decision, but what it does do is if you have Mary Jo White on the other side and she says, I want to make a presentation, you listen long and hard and you prepare accordingly because you know that the person is going to have great representation. And in sophisticated cases, there is great representation. But the other way, it can benefit us because while we're investigating, if I can get the defense lawyer to, in a good faith way, make a presentation to me about the facts, that can jumpstart it. Now, that may be in the defense's interest if they believe that by jumpstarting it, they can make this go quicker. But it can also be in the government's interest because we can be more efficient. So the bottom line to your question is, it's a factor in the sense that we know that complicated cases are highly well represented, but it doesn't affect our decision making. But what it could do is if a very good lawyer is able to show me why we shouldn't bring the case, and they're able to leapfrog it and to show in a very good way what the facts are. Sometimes, you know, you think in other cases where lawyers are less good, you wish they would do that, and they haven't done that. I see that when presentations are made to me. Some lawyers are excellent and some lawyers are less good. Sometimes those are in complicated cases and someone picked a good lawyer versus a bad lawyer. But it's one of the realities of our system. And it's up to me and my team not to let the quality of the lawyering in any way intimidate us, but rather it's our requirement regardless to get to the bottom of the facts. A good lawyer may just make you able to do that quicker.
You know, and this may sound like a platitude, but the prosecutor's job really is to do the right thing. And I mean, when I was in the government, I know you're laughing at that, but really they mean it and they ought to mean it. I mean, always, I'm not suggesting it always is the case, and it certainly should be. But if you get a presentation from a lawyer who's not so good, I mean, what, you know, we would used to talk about internally is, look, that wasn't a very effective presentation, but let's make sure we get this right. You know, let's sort of, you know, make sure the client doesn't suffer because of the lawyer. Now, that's not to say, you know, you can't do all the work of every defense attorney, obviously, but, you know, you really do try to get it right and make up for representation that isn't, you know, at that level for all people, but I'm not suggesting you can rectify it all.
I mean, not to be superficial about it, it's not that hard to indict an individual, and it's not that hard to indict a company. And if all you want to do is get a good press release or a good, you know, a lot of people applauding the government, you know, we could do it, and then, you know, in a year or two or 3 years later, maybe we pay the consequence. Our job is to get it right. And that's the exercise we're involved in.
Let me pick up on something Lenny just said. The hard thing is to do the investigation properly, thoroughly, to do the hard work, read the emails, come up with a theory, and understand what happened. I think the frustration that I had and that the public has right now is that there's sometimes quite clearly that the federal government is intentionally getting in the way. And I don't think that's the case anymore, but it certainly was the case. And while I have been very deferential, rightly so, and will continue to be to both Mary Jo and Lanny, who were superb when they were in government, Mary Jo's case, public servants. I just want to tell you, there when I was at AG, and we opened an investigation into subprime lending, the OCC, the Office of the Control of the Currency, the primary federal agency overseeing the banks, went into court to shut us down. They didn't come into court to say, yes, this is an important issue. You may not have jurisdiction, but we will then supplement your jurisdiction to join you to investigate all the issues that then metastasized into our crisis. They affirmatively went into court to fight us, and we had to go all the way to the Supreme Court, finally only winning in 2009, 5-4, to get the jurisdiction to look at the very issues that should have been investigated. So this was a grotesque, heinous example of industry capture. An OCC whose budget is paid for by the banks, controlled by the banks. We would go into court and would be an assistant AG out of my office sitting there, Dieter Snell, spectacular lawyer, who was litigating. I think he was in the office with you, Mary Jo. You hired him. Great
another
lawyer.
One of those, right?
And he was litigating against the lawyers for all the banks and the federal government. The federal government was there as the puppet, the pawn, the mouthpiece for the banks. It was heinous. And that is what was going on for many years. And so while we today are saying, yes, things are better, and I give full credit to what Lanny is saying, until pretty recently, the federal government was on the wrong side. And we should appreciate that.
Yeah, and by the way, I don't want to for one moment suggest, I mean, I don't want to talk about any particular matter. Elliot was involved in that one, I wasn't. But there's absolutely no question. We need for this to work vigilant regulators. They're the experts, they're the subject matter experts, and we clearly don't want regulators that are captured by an industry. I mean, obviously that is not something that we can promote, nor should we countenance.
But back there.
This question is for you, Mr. Brewer. I wonder if, you know, that 60 Minutes piece that I think some of us may have seen, you know, sort of portrayed that particular, and I know you may not be able to talk about that particular instance of this woman from Countrywide who had sort of, she said, I have this information, right? And I think when a lot of people look at that, that's where they say, hey, look, there's a person who's out here who has this information. How, you know, is that possibly a way that maybe that visceral need, you know, what I obviously understand you're limited in what you can take on, all that sort of thing. You can't take everything everyone says, but I'm wondering if maybe you can respond to
Absolutely.
That aspect a little bit.
And for those of you you who missed the 60 minutes. My mother may forgive you for missing it, but basically I went on 60 minutes to talk in essence about these issues, but there was someone from Countrywide who'd worked at Countrywide who said, look, you know, I knew about wrongdoing at Countrywide and the FBI, no one ever spoke to me. So one thing, not in any way to be defensive, but obviously that predated me, and also it was prosecuted by the U.S. Attorney in Los Angeles. Now, I know the current U.S. Attorney in Los Angeles, and he's a terrific person, and he works very hard. Look, we're a big country. I can't explain in a particular case why somebody wasn't interviewed. People who work with me know that I find that completely unacceptable. I'm very tough about interviewing witnesses. Indeed, I want my prosecutors interviewing witnesses as well, not just the agents. Look, if you're a whistleblower and you have something to say, we should go after you. But as I said on 60 Minutes, and I say here, I want whistleblowers coming forward. I mean, if you really have information and you really want to tell, my hope would be you wouldn't just wait for someone to knock on the door. I mean, there are telephones. You can tweet. You can let the government know that you want to talk, and hopefully someone will pick up, right? So it's a little bit of a balance. But, of course, I do get it. We're a decentralized system. We have 94 U.S. attorneys' offices. The FBI is terrific, but, I mean, everybody is busy. So I can't say in one particular case why she wasn't interviewed. I can say she should have been interviewed. I want her to be interviewed. I want every whistleblower to come forward. But that's sort of the reality of an imperfect world.
Let me ask a follow-up question for all of you to answer if you'd like. You know, I think one of the remarkable things that we've seen, and I think that, it, you know, when you look at the savings and loan crisis and you saw, you know, more than 1,000, if not thousands of bank executives who went to jail over these cases, and you look to what's happened recently, one of the things that have changed is the amount of resources available, particularly, and the expertise from the FBI, for better or for worse. I don't mean to suggest that it was for worse. I mean, the reality is that after the September 11 attacks, there was a tremendous refocus of the FBI's resources away from white-collar crime, away from everything that was not terrorism. And I'm not criticizing that, but it is certainly a reality. It started, you saw it at probably the very beginning of it, Mary Jo, at the end of your reign. My run at the U.S. Attorney's Office really from 2000 to 2008 saw that happen. And by the time we got to 2008 and we started up a mortgage fraud group, they're just the amount of resources available were so much less. And they started pulling resources back into doing mortgage fraud, but really that meant all other types of white-collar fraud suffered from investigators. And what you saw was a real degradation of the skill level and set of agents who have not been spending 5 or 6 or 7 years, you know, training on these complex investigations. So I guess the follow-up question is, and this, you sort of alluded to this earlier about these, the big firms and everything. I mean, do you think, how much of an impact do you think that the lack of available resources, of really well-trained, well-experienced resources, and in New York we were always sort of had embarrassment of riches, but I know elsewhere in the country at SIGTARP I would deal with U.S. Attorney's Office that had one white-collar FBI agent for the entire district to doing all of their cases. Like, how much of an impact do we think that might have had?
Let me address that, but first let me, I don't agree with the initial premise, so I just want to say it. You know, I'm often asked about the SNL crisis and say, well, why is it different now? I actually think, going back to what I said before, that it's somewhat, in my view, at least analogous to the SNL crisis. In the SNL crisis, people all over the country were indicted or prosecuted or sued civilly, and they tended to be local bankers in local areas, sometimes for relatively modest amounts of money. And I would say to all of you in this room, that's what's happened now. That's what's happened over the last 3 years. 2,100 people have been charged just for mortgage-related cases around the country. In the SNL crisis, we weren't putting in jail the Wall Street barons, and that's the criticism here. But don't assume, because you're all living in Manhattan, that right now in all these investment frauds and mortgage frauds and related that we aren't doing it. So I think actually what's going on is somewhat analogous. Look, as the Attorney General has said, as the FBI Director says, as everyone says, the number one priority will always be to keep this country safe. And it's safe from terrorism, right? I'm the Assistant Attorney General of the Criminal Division. There's now a National Security Division. There wasn't a National Security Division a few years ago. Congress decided we needed to have one because of our nation's, of course, constant vigilant fight against terrorism. But I will say that with the cutbacks, there has been, and I've fought very hard for this, there are far more increased resources to what we would call traditional crime and traditional white-collar crime. I don't think we'll ever be in a post-9/11 scenario where a good amount of our resources aren't fighting terrorism, but there's no question that we have more resources. And just to go back to your first question, and that's also, frankly, the reason why we do need things like this task force, because we are in a world where partnerships matter. The Criminal Division can no longer work alone. We have to work with U.S. attorneys, and we have to work with great state AGs and local DAs and the like, and that's why we have more and more task forces.
Do you guys have to comment?
I would observe this about resources. I think Lanny's right. Obviously, the prioritization that comes from the Oval Office down through Justice is right in terms of where you got to start. Having said that, I think that the lack of resources is too often used as an excuse for the failure of cases to have been made. And again, I hate to sort of roll out the AG's office when I was there in subsequent years. I think we had 10 lawyers total doing investor protection, 10. Compared to the thousands of agents in the FBI and white collar and around the nation. I think sometimes having fewer resources is better. And I've often said the SEC was somewhat like GM. When you get so big and lumbering, you don't know how to change. You can't see what needs to be changed because you're simply not thinking as creatively as you must think when you are small and therefore resource stressed. And I think there's something to be said for being small and nimble and being forced to say, how do we make the cases that matter most as opposed to simply processing what's on the conveyor belt? So I think sometimes resources get in the way. And Lanny's right, there were fewer resources available in white-collar prosecutorial offices around the nation because they were shifted away from everything from organized crime and securities to terrorism. And that made sense. That was the right thing to do. But that didn't really diminish the OCC, the SEC, all the banking regulatory agencies, the FDIC. They had their entire regulatory apparatus, and they were the ones who should have generated the information flow up to justice to make the cases, or at least to flag the crises that were emerging. When the subprime, to focus on what really did, in fact, finally culminate in lighting the fuse for the financial crisis, everybody who came close to subprime debt knew this was a crisis. There was fraud endemic, and it was being marketed illegally and improperly. And the agencies that were not cut back still failed to pass that information on. That is where the feds failed.
A little known fact, though, is that in the Southern District of New York and a lot of other of the big U.S. attorney's offices, and in the SEC for that matter, it's the lawyers who actually do the investigating.
Right.
And in the AG's
office.
So even though you had a dislocation of resources after 9/11 for obvious reasons, still do, I at least didn't have the perception, easy for me to say on the eighth floor probably, Neil, but that we were diverted, obviously to some degree everybody was diverted and should have been, but from the white collar, the pursuit of the white collar crime. I mean, obviously the SEC's done some other things like bring in traders, so they can understand the transactions. That's a good thing. Which I think is important as well.
I would say that generally that characterization is true about the attorneys doing the investigations, except, of course, when the agents came from the Office of the Special Inspector General of the Troubled Asset Relief Program, ours were the best and the brightest.
No, I was just going to say on Elliot's point, which is obviously very important, it has to be said, if you look at someone like the Director of Enforcement, Rob Kuzami, or his deputy, Lauren Reisner, who's now the CRIM chief in the Southern District, I mean, they've just transformed the SEC, and you do have to be nimble. I mean, one just a small little example, it was very important to me that even in my own division, that any case that was old, if it was an old case, there had to be a pretty good excuse, and otherwise you weren't going to be able to hide behind this old case just to shape it like a beautiful vase. And as a result of that, just to give you one little anecdote, the public integrity section, which basically has a roughly 20 elite lawyers in the history of the public integrity section, probably never had more than 3 or 4 trials a year. Last year we had, with 20 lawyers, forgetting all our investigations, we had 17 trials. It's just a focus. So I couldn't agree more with Elliot's point. We have to be nimble, and we have to keep reexamining how we're doing things. And our regulators have to do that as well.
I'm really sad to say that we're out of time, but I would like to once again thank our panelists. Please join me in thanking them for, I think, this great panel. Exceeded expectations, and thank you.
I thank all of you for coming.
Great,
Dieter, I'm always glad to be able to mention Dieter. Dieter was standing.